I would like to thank Professor Mona Prohiji for inviting me and giving me this platform to share my views with you. I also thank the Honorable Vice Chancellor of Barkatullah University, Professor Ajay Rao, sir, and co-speakers, Dr. Srivastav and Dr. Pandey. RTI, as we all know, the topic or the seminar, webinar, which is going on this RTI Act of 2005, issues and challenges. So now with respect, what are the challenges and the topic on which I'm supposed to talk to you? So let us break that topic into four parts. When, why, what, and where has been given a form. Now, the topic is very challenging and is open for a number of interpretations and various descriptions part of this. What to speak, where to speak, why to speak, and when to speak. And this is what Right to Information Act says for. Now, if I say when, I will start with the when, then really when is something which is related to the evolution or the initialization of the right to information. And for that, we have to go back to the history of the Right to Information Act. The second part of the lecture, that is why. Then we have to see as to what was the need to bring this Right to Information Act. And for that, various reasons, various causes on which this Right to Information Act has been developed and evolved and has been brought us before us as a as an act. So we have to discuss in that why we require this Right to Information Act. Now, if we talk about the what, then naturally what is something as to what we have received from this Right to Information Act, what right we have received, what we are doing by that Right to Information Act, what procedure we are following, and finally when we reach to where, then that where shows as to what are various issues and challenges, where we are after 2005. 2005 is the year this Right to Information Act was enforced. Past 15th June 2005, few sections have been enforced on the very date, and finally it has been enforced on October 2005. Fine. So since then, what we are doing and where we are. So these are the four aspects on which I'll try to share my views with you all. So first of all, when it has started. As we know that in India, we are living in a globalized world. Today, everything is globalized and we know everyone, everything through the internet. We are international network, we are in the international network system, which we have been proved through this corona period that everything is going on virtually. And this is the very effective method of knowing each other. And simply in that way, I must bring to your attention that 1766 was the year when for the first time this freedom of information type thing was started in Sweden. So that has taken the lead, that when we started or when we came to know as to this something like freedom of information. Now, where from this freedom of information come into picture in India, then we have to look back again a globalized in the globalization and the UHR, that is Universal Declaration of Human Rights 1948, which clearly and specifically provides for freedom under Article 19 clause 2. It's not only the UDHR, but there are so many instruments internationally also where we find that right information was available, whether it be International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, whether it be the European Commission Human Rights, its American Convention, its St. George Convention, so matter. Then Rome Charter, there are various, we can say, international instruments where we find that right to information is one of the human right. And India, when we have enforced our constitution in 1950, our constitution not provided a direct right to information. It was only Article 19(1)(a), which speaks about the freedom of speech and expression, that has been, we can say, interpreted so liberally by the court of law that it is known as the freedom of speech and expression has been extended or has brought within its right to information. So the liberal interpretation, that's where the right to information has been brought in the Constitution of India, not directly, not specifically, explicitly. But now, besides this, other history, we can say when this has been passed, the movement, public movement that we must not forget is the Mazdoor Kisan Shakti Sangathan in the 1990s, early 90s. Which started in Rajasthan, and the continued movement of this MKASS, that is through Annamalai Nikhilde and other persons from the Madhya Pradesh, and it was initiated simply because of having the muster roll or the wage record for the village panchayat. And this movement has been so, we can say, vigorously taken down that various judges from Delhi and other states, they have gone there and they have published their stories, and that has brought the momentum so that some states have started to enact the right to information for their states. And Tamil Nadu and these two states have pioneered in bringing this right to information in 1997. And after that, other states were also there which have brought their Right to Information Act. It be Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh also brought Right to Information. Then UP has brought certain regulations. Delhi state has brought this Right to Information. So at state level, there were various laws which have been brought in by the state governments, state service for Right to Information. Now, at center level, what that was doing? So we all are aware of the emergency of 1975, which was again a self-inflicted wound on the government side. And after that emergency, the party in power, that is Janata government, and Morarji Desai, who was the prime minister, then they have in their slogan, or we can say protest, they said that we will this to information as a law. So in 1977, there was some, we can say, thing which has come out that right to information has to be brought. And after that, committees were appointed. So many things were continued that right to information has to be there. But finally, it was in 1997, a committee was appointed to bring this right to information, and they started working. And after that, in 1997, a Freedom of Information Bill was introduced, that was brought before the Minister's Committee under the chairmanship of the Prime Minister. There were so many amendments, and this continued this system for the amending the right to information, the draft model, the model, and finally it a shape in 2002. When Freedom of Information Act was passed. So before this 2002, there were reports of the National Commission for the Review of the Working of the Constitution through Justin Venkatachalaiah, H.D. Shuri draft bill, then Pranab Mukherjee, as he was then the chairman of the Parliamentary Standing Committee from the Home Affairs. So all they have gone through the various provisions of the right to information, and at the same time, this right to information was brought in 2002 as a Freedom of Information Act. But because there were certain, we can say, loopholes, there were certain lacuna that act could not be enforced properly. And finally, we see that in 2005, we have a Right to Information Act. Now, this Right to Information Act is having 31 sections, and various powers have been conferred. All the provisions have been mentioned as to whom the information has to be given, who can sort the information, what is the time period, what is the provision for appeal, will be disclosed or not, or there are certain documents which are said to be the privileged document. So all these things are incorporated in the Act of 2005. So if we say that when of the right to information, then this when started from globally 1766, it reached to India in 2005 finally, and in between we have seen the other states also, like US, it has enacted its right to information in 1966. In other countries, UK in 2000. So that was the period when this Right to Information Act was being enacted in various globally as well as in Indian states also, and finally we got it in 2000. So the topic which has been chosen by the organizer, that is always a contemporary topic that will always remain relevant topic, because information is something which requires for the skilled aspect of my talk, that is why we require this right to information. Now we are all a human being, we all know that we have a right to speech and expression. Why it is required that we should have this right, fundamental, this right to information as a statutory right? Because it is not in the Constitution of India. So Constitution provided for a democratic nation. We are a larger democracy in the world, and one of the rights of the, or one of the, we can say, extension or expansion of the democracy is that it does not confer a right to the acquisition of the power, acquisition of authority, but democracy means to confer the acquisition of the eligibility, acquisition of the capacity. Capacity for what? Capacity to realize that the authority, if it is not working properly, then, or if it is abusing the power, if it is misled, that democratic citizens, they may have the authority to sustain that, to contain that thing, to stop that thing, to stop the misusing or abusing of power. So democracy, we have adopted in our constitution the democracy, and one of the demand of the democracy is that the government is for the people, by the people, of the people. So once we say that the government is the people and by the people, for the people, then naturally what the government is doing, that must be known to the citizen. So this is the idea that why we require this right to information. And for this, we have to look back till we can say decisions or the judicial interpretation, wherein the court has started interpreting that right to freedom of speech and expression under Article 19(1)(a) also includes right to freedom of information, right to know rather. Because we know that until and unless we have been informed, until and unless we have the knowledge of something, we cannot exercise our right to speech and expression. So if we want to exercise our right to freedom of speech and expression, then naturally that right must have a correlative, and that correlative is information, knowledge. So once we have to know, only then we can exercise the speech and expression. And this was the, we can say, the gist of various judgments of the Supreme Court right from 1950. It is Ramesh Thapar in 1950, where this right to note of the freedom of speech has been started. And after that, a great jump, the Supreme Court 18, where it Raj Narayan versus S.P. Gupta versus Union of India, it may be Dinesh Trivedi case, it may be West Bengal Information Cricket Association Board case, and this continued right from 1950 and till 2002. And in 2002, the Supreme Court has extended this why, that is the citizen of a democratic nation, that the democracy would survive, the democracy would be vibrant only when the citizen, who is a voter also, that he must have the knowledge of as to what the government is doing. The person who is contesting the election, then whereabouts of that contestant, the person, that must be made known to the concerned, to the voter concerned. So this was the of the Supreme Court, that they continuously interpreting the fundamental freedom under Article 19(1)(a). Why? Just to bring the democracy. This was the need, because a democracy, if voters are not aware as to whom they are going to cast their vote, then naturally it will not be a good democracy. And that's why this need to be interpreted in terms of the voters' right to know. And the Supreme Court in 2002, it's an Association for Democratic Rights. Then after in 2003, then this PUCL, People's United for Civil Liberties. And after that, the system continued when the Supreme Court very categorically said that this right of the voter to know the whereabouts of the person who is contesting the election, that remains a fundamental right under Article 19(1)(a) of the Constitution. So the citizens of the country, they were enjoying this freedom of information, the freedom or right to know, because of the interpretation of the Supreme Court. And that right implemented through the court of law also. But why it is required that we need a separate statutory law? Because if we are demanding for a right to information, because I have told you in 2002, Freedom of Information Act was also enacted. And it could not be, you can say, implemented properly. Because freedom is a choice. Choice with the citizen. Freedom is a choice with the person concerned. He may or he may not, or if he is enjoying or exercising his freedom, maybe the authority may not provide the proper information. But once it becomes a right, then naturally the other person is having a correlative duty. Duty for what? Duty to provide. Duty to provide the information. And that's why this right is becoming a very necessity for a democratic nation like India. And this, we can say, why we require this? This is because we were in a democratic nation. And in that democracy, this freedom of information is required, because the government, what the government is doing, that must be made known to the citizen, because the government is nothing but they are the representatives of the common men, the citizens. So they are working there on behalf of the government, on behalf of the citizen. Citizens, they are the masters. They must know as to what they are doing. And it is not possible without this right to information. It was not possible without the interpretation of the Supreme Court. So I'm not going into detail as to what are the various facts and decisions of the Supreme Court in this case, which I have named before you. But the Supreme Court has not stopped interpreting. And at the same time, you see that very recently on 13 February 2020, the Supreme Court in Ram Babu Singh Thakur versus Sunil Arora, a contempt case was decided by the Supreme Court on the petition that the persons, the parties, the political parties, they are not providing the whereabouts of the persons who are contesting election. And the court has very categorically said, in that case in 2020, as well as in 2019 case of the People for the People Foundation for Information, that the person to whom the ticket being given by a political party, they must clarify that who were the persons who have sought for the ticket to fight against from that party. And it is not what are their qualifications, and everything has to be disclosed by the political party. It is not only that the winnability is the criteria, that the person who is in this situation who can win the election, that is not the only criteria, but the other qualifications must also be given, because if four persons are asking for that, then naturally all these four persons' qualification and the merit has to be placed or disclosed, and then to whom the vote, the ticket has been given, this has to be clarified. So this was the Ram Babu Singh versus Sunil Arora 2020 decision, and the court has also said that this has to be publicized everywhere. The social media is also a part of that, on WhatsApp group, on Facebook, on Twitter, everywhere you have to bring that to the knowledge of the voter, that they must know as to what and whereabouts of the person who is contesting the election. And that is why we can say that we have a democratic nation, and the democracy is very vibrant and it is working. properly. So the second aspect is why. So why we need this RTI? We need this RTI to run a democracy properly, which is again in the Constitution of India from the very five beginning words, we the people of India. On the last five words, that is, and to give ourselves this constitution. So what we have given to ourselves, that is the constitution, which speaks about its democratic, republic, sovereign and secular socialism aspect. So this democracy has to survive only when the people of India will be given this right to information. So why we have this right to information? This information is because we want to run a democracy. We want to run that our the persons who are governing us, they must not misuse their power, they must not abuse their power, and the governance should be a good governance, it should not be a bad governance. So this is how we can say that the democracy is one of the, or democratic values are one of the reason which has been there to bring this Right to Information Act. Now the third part, which is related to this lecture, that is what. Now if we say what, then what we have received from this Right to Information. Now for that we have looked into the various provisions of the Right to Information Act of 2005. That provides that every citizen shall have the right to have the information from the public authority. Now, what information the citizen can get from the public authority, that is mentioned in the Act itself. However, this right to information or to get the information, that is not an absolute right. Though it was not absolute as such in the Constitution of India also, because 19(2) provides certain reasonable restrictions. Similarly, this Act of 2005 also put certain restrictions, and those restrictions are given under Section 8 and 9 of the Right to Information Act. So maximum you see in it clause Section 8, 1, A, B, C, D, there are number of clauses. So A and B, that is simply what we find in Article 19, Clause 2. These are the restrictions. So here these are the provisions which are considered to be an exemption, that these are the areas right to information cannot be sought from the citizen. While if there is certain provision or certain application that some of the area which has been demanded or some of the information which has been demanded by the citizen, that comes under Section 8 of the RTI Act, and the others are not coming under that Act. So on that basis, Section 10 is there, which can be providing for the severability. That if you can sever, if you can make a distinction or division, that one part information can be given and the other part of the information cannot be given. So go through that, and this can be done under Section 10 of the Right to Information Act, which speaks about the severability. So every information is not possible in the name of sovereignty, in the name of security, in the name of the foreign relations or friendly relations with the others, the contempt of court and the copyright, intellectual property, personal rights. So this all has been given under Section 8 and 9, so that these are the things on which the information cannot be provided. However, the other things are there which can be provided to the person concerned. That too, the right, what right? That this is a time-bound, we can say, period that the information has to be received by the person who is asking or who is seeking the information from public authority. So the time-bound period is 30 days. Then if it is related to third party, another 10 days, another 5 days has to be given. If it is related to some other institution, then the time period is different. However, if it is a case of the violation of the human rights, then only 48 hours are required for that. Further, another area where we can say that what we have received and what are the areas where this right to information cannot be sought for, that is Section 8 of the Right to Information Act. Certain institutions have been categorized there, that these are the institutions relating to which the information cannot be sought by the citizen. But if it is a matter of the violation of human rights, then naturally information can be sought after following certain procedure. So this act also provides certain mechanisms which says about the composition and constitution of the state information commissioner, central information commissioner, that a public authority has to bring into this CPIOs and APIOs and state SPIOs. So the procedure is there in the act itself, and every public authority has to follow this thing. But what we are witnessing, where we are, whether the provisions which are there under this Right to Information Act, do we really follow those provisions? That the act provides in the section 4 that the public authority has to put everything on the website, and it has to be reasonably renewed every after a reasonable interval. And there are 17 manuals which are to be made under this RTI Act, which are to be placed on the website of the public authority. But we see that there are various public authorities' websites that you will find a link of the RTI, Right to Information. But whenever you will click that link, then you will find that nothing is there. So, or if something is there, that is not updated. So, the very purpose of the Right to Information Act and the very purpose of bringing this particular section on 15th June itself instead of 12th October was that the public authorities, they will prepare the things, and after that preparation, they'll put everything on their website so that maximum disclosure would be there and minimum information has to be given. But that is not the true thing. So this is where we are still fighting. The for the information, because another point is that there are certain lapses on the part of the public authorities also. There is no extra infrastructure, there is no training. So the act is for a periodical training, awareness programs and all this regarding RTI, but nothing is being done by the public authorities. So the act says that the awareness programs has to be by the public authorities, the trainings have to be given, but the APIOs and the CPIOs, the SPIOs who are there at the first stage to give the information, they are first untrained, they are reluctant also, they have been not provided any infrastructure to do the things, and they are also living, or they have not come out from that steel frame of the bureaucracy which speaks about the secrecy, because India was a country which continued in the secrecy. Official Secrets Act was there since 1923. So to come out from that, 15 years have been completed, almost on 15th we'll be completing 15 years of this Right to Information. But the situation is that we are where we were there, but to some extent, the good governance, the transparency, the responsiveness of the governance has been brought in by the Right to Information Act. The activists, they are working, but for a common man, it becomes very difficult because he's not aware of what to do. The act itself provides that if a person who is not able to write, then the application may be written by the person by the PIO of that public authority. But who knows it, and who is telling these citizens that you have this right and you can have the information, you can seek the information from the public authority. And on the other hand, some misuse of the act is there. Because just in order to have inquiries or information from the public authority, which is of no use, just to, we can say, enhance the work of the public authority or the PIOs, they are just giving or seeking information on the similar things, or daily there are the things. So on both sides, it is on the side of the citizen who is seeking the information, it is on the side of the public authority officials who are providing. We are not having that thing completely, we can say, as what was the object behind this Right to Information Act, because Right to Information Act or the information item is not found in this schedule to the Constitution. In neither list, either list 1, list 2 or list 3, this information is not a subject. And that's why this Pranab Mukherjee committee, when they suggested the Right to Information Act, that this has to become under entry 97 list 1 as a residuary subject. So being a residuary subject, this has been brought into picture, this has been enforced also, but so far as the functioning of this act is concerned, it is working, but it is not working as it has to work. Good governance, that is we can say to be there because of this Right Information Act, that is not achieved. Very latestly, you must all be aware about, as that during COVID-19, we are all, we can say, in the middle of that coronavirus, and we are staying at our home as a fact of quarantine. There is one weekend report which I was going through in the newspaper regarding this PM Care Fund, which has been, we can say, constituted after this COVID, so that the money can be from that fund, and the care can be taken from using that fund. So whether it's this under the RTI or not, simply it has been said that it will not be covered under the Right to Information. So when we see that public authority, which is defined under Section 4 of the RTI Act, that if it is made under the constitutional, by the constitution, by the state legislature, by the parliament, or by a notification. So if we see that the receipts and the name of the fund and the persons who are working for, they are all there, but the simply by saying that it is not covering under the Right to Information, so information cannot be given. So let us see that what the courts do in this matter, because this is an open-ended question whether this PM Care Fund will be there or not. So where we are after the Information Act, simply I can say that come from one place to another place because of this Right to Information Act. We have achieved to something better than what we were having earlier, and now we can say that to some extent we are able to get the information, though through the activists, those the persons who are aware about, but at the same time we have to bring into something in the act so that this abuse and misuse of the power may be stopped, may be contained, and we can enjoy the right of information for which this act was enacted. Thank you very much. So if there is any question, I'll be happy.